everybody. Welcome to another edition of Foley Football Classics. I'm Clark Stewart. While there have been many, many great teams in the long and storied history of Foley football, the 1977 Lions hold a unique and special place. The Lions were led that year by a power running offense that would score 228 points, an average of 23 points per game, and a bone-crushing defense that would post five shutouts and give up just 40 points in the regular season, the lowest total allowed by a Foley defense since the 1964 season. One of the Lions' finest performances during that historic season came in Week 8 when they played host to the Gators of Satsuma High School. That's the subject of this edition of Foley Football Classics, but before we get into the game, let's take a look back at Weeks 1 through 7 of that classic 1977 season.
The Lions opened the 1977 season on the road, taking on the Golden Bears of Robertsdale. Things appeared shaky for the Lions as a stagnant performance by the offense resulted in the Bears holding a 6-0 lead midway through the fourth quarter. But just when all appeared lost, Eric Kennedy, number 11, took over as quarterback and led the offense on a 55-yard drive that was capped off by a 20-yard touchdown catch by receiver Larry Schutz. A successful extra point attempt gave the Lions a 7-6 lead. With 5 minutes still left on the clock, the Bears attempted a comeback, but in an omen of many things to come, the Lion defense stood like a stone wall and preserved the 7-6 victory. Following a Week 2 victory over the Mary Montgomery Vikings, the Lions would play host to the perennial powerhouse Pine Forest Eagles of Pensacola. The Eagles took a 7-6 lead late in the first quarter, but behind a 95-yard kickoff return by running back Byron Dean and a 71-yard punt return by receiver Clovis Snowden, the Lions would go on to blow out the Eagles by a score of 42-13. The following 3 weeks would see the Lions score crushing victories over the BC Rain Red Raiders, the Williamson Lions, and the Tomanville Rattlers. This stretch saw the defensive unit of linemen Steve Allen, Anthony Yontz, Kim Hamrick, Greg Parker, and Robert Evans, together with the linebacking core of Bobby Ray, Doug Suttle, and Mark Farish, and defensive backs Dennis Lane, Larry Schutz, and Clovis Snowden, hold opponents scoreless for 9 straight quarters. So dominating and so fierce was the Lion defense that one newspaper saw fit to label them as tougher than jerky and meaner than junkyard dogs. This 3-game stretch also saw the offense, which had appeared inept during the first game, grow into a scoring machine. Led by Eric Kennedy at quarterback, Robert Cantrell, number 33, at fullback, and the Dean brothers, Byron, number 21, and Russell, number 23, at halfback. Together with the receiving core of Pat Laurendean, Clovis Snowden, and Paul Doring, and the offensive line of center Tom Byrne, guards George Surrey and Kenny Neal, and tackles Al Cowart and Lester Warner, the Lions outscored their 3 opponents 97-6. With a 6-0 record under their belts, the Lions went on the road in Week 7 to take on the equally undefeated Atmore Blue Devils. As had happened with Pine Forest, the Lions trailed early, but sparked by a 40-yard touchdown run by Byron Dean and a 55-yard punt return by Clovis Snowden, The Lions would cruise past the Blue Devils to a convincing 29-13 victory. Now at 7-0, the Lions would travel back home for a critical Week 8 matchup with their regional rivals, the Satsuma Gators.
And a critical matchup it was. Both teams had a lot riding on the outcome of this game. For the Lions, a victory would continue their hopes for an undefeated season, something the Foley team had not accomplished since 1962. It would also snap a two-game losing streak to the Gators, and perhaps most importantly of all, a victory would put the Lions in the driver's seat to win the Region 2 championship and earn a spot in the playoffs. Joining us to watch and discuss the game are head coach Lester Smith and defensive coordinator Bud Pigott. First of all, Coach Smith, let's take a look back at the week leading up to the Satsuma game in 1977. Talk about the preparation for the game going into that Week 7 matchup, all the implications of this game, and some of the emphasis on the offense as you were heading into that matchup was the fact that Satsuma had won the previous two matchups, and it was really a serious rivalry back in that era. Was that any extra motivation for the team?
I think it was. Satsuma had a really good team during those years. Billy Coleman was the head coach at Satsuma, and they did an outstanding job. And as you mentioned, in 1975 and 76, they had beaten us both years, I think 14-2 in 75 and 10-7 in 76 in Satsuma. The players were really ready to play this game. We had a great week of preparation. We knew what was at stake. The region championship pretty much was on the line at that point, even though we had two games left to play. The defense really was ready to play. They were ready to play the entire season. As you mentioned, we gave up a total of 40 points the entire season, which, and looking back at the history, only four times since the late 40s that we'd given up as few as 40 points in a game, 40 points in a season, I should say. So it was a really big week for us, preparation-wise. The team had worked really hard all season long, and they were ready to play in that ball game.
Coach Bud Pigott, again with us. Coach Pigott, as we entered that Week 7 matchup against the Gators, talk about what you were thinking about from the defensive side, and I know that you were getting ready to match up again in this rivalry with Satsuma. And under their head coach, Billy Coleman, that you had quite a history with as a player, both at the junior college level as opponents, as I understand it, and then later on teammates on a national championship game team at Southern Miss. So talk about everything that you were thinking about going into that Week 7 matchup with Satsuma.
Well, they'd always been competitors. Their head coach, who I played against in junior college and then played with at Southern Miss, he was a fierce competitor himself. And he always liked to running power plays, an option, and a sprint-out pass. And looking at them as we was getting ready to play this year, I felt like the sprint-out pass with his son was playing quarterback, so he was a pretty good scrambler. And when a sprint-out quarterback gets outside of your containment, it puts big pressure on your defensive backs trying to keep them covered, particularly in all the combination routes in the flat. So we felt like our end play was going to be crucial. And was definitely going to have to contain, in other words, keep them out. I always call it keep them out of the grass, because them quick little darting backs that get out in the grass, they can make a fool out of you pretty quick. But our ends did a pretty good job, and even our three techniques, I think we used them some rather than pursuing upfield. That they played a little soft technique to help contain the quarterback and make any plays so that he couldn't get out of containment.
Thank you, Coach Smith. Coach Pigott, we'll be back with first quarter action, Foley versus Satsuma, 1977, right after this. Welcome back to Foley Football Classics. As we take a look back at the 1977 game between the Foley Lions and the Satsuma Gators. Captains meet at midfield, Bobby Ray and Doug Sutter.
Steve Allen, Greg Parker, Robert Cantrell, I think, was in on the tackle. Mark Farish.
Clovis Snowden.
Clovis Snowden, Dennis Lane, who was a sophomore that year. Third one, big stop for us.
Doug Allen, Bobby Ray.
Steve Allen, big play to get us a three and out.
Along the front there, we see Steve Allen, the middle, number 85. Greg Parker, defensive end, number 30. Robert Evans, number 80, on the other end. Anthony Yonks, number 68.
Kim Hamrick, in the ball game, defensive tackle.
And this group really loved punt returns.
Mark Farish on the return. Several big blocks on the play, forcing a Gator punt.
One of them probably had to be Bobby Ray.
The replay.
Doug Sullivan picked up one. Anthony Yonks. Clovis Snowden leading the way. Who is that, Greg Parker?
Yes.
We had a really good wall return in those years. Coach Pikett worked with the punt return unit and did a really good job setting that up. We did a lot of shifting in this game. We tried to give them a last-second look at our offense. Eric Kennedy, quarterback, one of the really smart quarterbacks we had. They were going to make him carry the ball, and Eric did a great job. He carried the ball, I think, 20 times in this game for 82 yards. The offensive line, of course, really came off the ball well, coached by Barry Pittington. I don't think we threw but three passes in the game that I recall. We completed two out of three passes, but had nearly 300 yards rushing in the game.
On the offensive line, Al Cowart, Lester Warner, George Surrey, Kenny Neal, Tom Burnett, center.
Paul Dorian, tight end, Pat Laurendine, outside. Russell Dean making a really good block on the outside. That was in the days that you could block below the waist on the option play. Big first down to keep the drive going. Harry Kennedy on quarterback sneak. Behind Tom Byrne, Kenny Neal, Lester Warner on the right side. The wishbone was our primary offense, but we did some shifting and did some other things to try to confuse them a little bit. We ran the down line option quite a bit. That was just our base option, what we call base 27. This is what we call 48. Usually we did it with a crackback, 48 with a crackback with a wide out, sometimes with a double crackback with a slot in the wide out. Again, they were going to make Eric carry the ball. They didn't want to pitch the ball to Byron and Russell Dean, which I could understand, and Eric took advantage of it and really picked up some big yards for us, many times 3, 4, 5 yards to get us in a short yardage situation or pick up a first down. Here again was the 48 double crackback. Really good job on the outside by Russell Dean. Offensive line really firing off the ball well. This play we call an outside veer. It was a dive play reading the defensive end with Russell Dean carrying the ball. Yes, that son was playing pretty soft on the outside and made Eric turn up and run the ball many times. That was a big play. We had three and out on defense, and then we knocked it in the first time. A 12-play drive, all 12 plays on the ground. Really good job. Offensive line coming off the ball really well. Good fake to our fullback, Greg Parker. Eric took it in for the touchdown.
Coach Pikett commenting on the crowd. There's a great crowd, standing room only crowd in the stadium that night, as it was every Friday night.
Greg Parker with extra point. He was 3 for 3 that night.
So the Lions draw first blood, take a 7-0 lead in the first quarter. Kicking off to the Gators. Once again, the kickoff team all over it. First and 10 sets in.
Steve Allen and some help.
Steve Allen almost takes a handoff on that play. And boy,
another play.
Show it again.
Got a little face mask.
Guys, for a face mask, that was their first down in the game. They didn't get the three first downs in the game, and two of those were on penalties by us.
Had him contained. He had to turn back, and their inside pursuit caught him.
Steve Allen doing what you want your nose guard to do, isn't he?
Steve Allen, great job. Greg Parker turning it in. Steve Allen with a big play. Bobby Ray coming in. Very close. Doug Sutter.
Not only was this team
Doug Sutter out there.
End of the first quarter, Foley goes to quarter number two with a 7-0 lead. Welcome back. Second quarter action, 1977, Foley hosting Satsuma in a classic Region 2 battle. Lions holding a 7-0 lead going into the second stanza.
There's a little cutback play by Robert Cantrell. We call it, I think, 43 cutback. Again, we did a lot of shifting in the ball game. Didn't really mess them up that much, but it gave them one split second later to see what we were actually trying to do. What we call a 22 counter, a counter play to Russell Dean. Offensive line really coming off the ball well. Got 8 yards, I believe, on that play. Again, they're forcing our quarterback, Eric Kennedy, to keep the ball. This was one of two times that we actually stopped ourselves in the game on penalties, and one time with a turnover. They never really stopped us in the game. I think we punted about one time, but they never really stopped us. I don't think they would have stopped us that time had we not had a penalty.
Fourth and 16, the Lions will punt it.
Mike Benn, left-footed punter.
Good play by Parker.
3-yard gain for the Satsuma Gators.
Greg makes another play. Everybody was in on that one.
Fourth down and two forces a Gator punt. Three and out.
I think that was Clovis Snowden on the last two punt returns. Again, counter play. Again, offensive line's coming off the ball well. Picked up 5 yards on that play. Satsuma had a really good defense in those years. They were very sound fundamentally, very basic, 5-2 defense, and played really, really well. Byron Dean on a nice pickup. Good fake to Greg Parker. You see the offensive line really coming off the ball well. They came off really low and hard, trying to get that outside knee. This is a great run by Russell Dean, 63 yards.
Dean outruns everybody to the end zone on the way to another Lions touchdown.
Really good fake inside, offensive line on that side, on the right side, Ken Neal, and Lester Werner, Tom Byrne, making big blocks, and then Russell does the rest once he gets an open field. Very tough to catch.
Russell Dean, I believe, a senior on this team, and his younger brother, Byron, I believe, was a junior.
A junior, that's correct. 2-for-2 for Greg Parker. Mike Benton was the holder.
14-0, 4:04 remaining in the first half. Larry.
Yeah, Larry shoots. Kicked out for us. Larry's playing left cornerback. He was a junior that.
Boom. All right, so.
By Doug Sutton. He was a strong linebacker, covering the flat.
Another look at it. Bingo.
I think Sassoon just completed one or two passes in this game. They didn't have 56 yards for the game in this game.
Big Anthony.
Anthony Youngs.
And Allen.
A left defensive tackle.
We can shed the block. Watch him shed the block.
On the Steve out. They would get after it.
Yeah.
That's pressure on quarterback when somebody's breathing down his neck and he's still got to run. He's contained.
Mark Farish on the coverage that time.
Larry Shoes. Steve Allen.
Penalty against the Gator.
Robert Evans, defensive left end. Kim Hamrick, right defensive tackle, number 62.
Bobby Ray.
Steve Allen, 85.
Anthony Yachts was in there too, I think, wasn't he?
Fourth and 24, the Gators will punch them there into the field. Chloe Snowden.
Boom.
Somehow Clovis manages to slip a few tackles on that one. Follow the football, first down and 10. Kennedy at quarterback. The handoff to Parker up the middle. This line's a little more real estate to work with here. End of the first half. Foley will take it into the locker room at intermission, leading the Gators 14-0. We'll come back with some halftime thoughts right after this. Welcome back to this edition of Foley Football Classics, Foley versus Satsuma. While the Foley band from Lionland was entertaining the crowd at halftime, the Foley coaching staff and team went into the locker room with a 14-0 lead, and we'll ask our coaches about some of the things that were on your mind as you held that 14-0 lead against a very good Satsuma team. Coach Smith, your thoughts as you headed into the locker room at intermission.
Well, at that point, I felt pretty good about it because we had gained, I think, 143 yards, and they'd gained 31. They didn't have but one first down that they actually earned. They got one on a penalty by us. But they never really had stopped us, and even though we had only one really big play, the 63-yard run by Russell, I knew we could move the ball because we had moved the ball, and they really hadn't stopped us the entire game. We stopped ourselves one time with a penalty, but other than that, we moved the ball real well against them. The defense was playing great. They were really ferocious. I knew the Satsuma wasn't going to score very many points against us. And the two previous years, we'd only scored 9 points in 2 years against them. So in 75 and 76, both of them were close games, but we lost both of them. But the offense was moving the ball, the defense was playing great, and so I knew that we were in really good shape.
Go to Coach Bud Pike. Coach, your thoughts from the defensive side and your ability to that point to pretty well control and shut down the Gators' offense.
Well, I felt like we just keep doing what we've been doing since they hadn't threatened us, and everything we were doing was seemed to be working out all right. And we go back and say, hey, we know we're not going to give them a big play. We may even play a little more cautious and not give them the big play, and it'd be hard for them to get back in the game, judging on what they've done so far in the first half.
And we'll come back with second half action, Foley versus Satsuma, 1977, right after this. Welcome back, second half action, Foley taking on Satsuma, 1977, leading the Gators 14-0 as we enter the third quarter.
Byron Dean on the kickoff return. We've mentioned offensive lineup, but Al Coward, number 55 at left tackle. We got George Surrey, number 70 at left guard. Tom Byrne at center, number 54. Kenny Deal at right guard, number 63. Les Warner, 78 at right tackle. Pat Lardine, number 19 at split end. And Paul Doran, number 40 at tight end.
Nice pitch that time by Kennedy. Beautifully done to Russell Dean, around the left side.
That was the main part of offense during the course of the season, what we call base 27, also base 38 to the other side, where we fake the ball to fullback. Sometimes we would read it from inside out, and sometimes it would just be a base option where it would be a pitch or a key by the quarterback.
Beautifully executed. First down and 10.
They faked the ball again to Greg Parker. They took away the pitch there several times, so Eric kept the ball and made 3, 4, 5, 6 yards several times. We shifted into a strong formation, what we call a special strong. Threw a little pass. I think that was the first pass we threw in the game. Nice completion to Pat Lardine. And Pat caught another one later on in the ball game as well. I think we were 2 out of 3. With our first group, and he caught both of them. Byron Dean, great run, number 21.
I see Dennis Lane, sophomore, I think, on that team, wasn't
he? Yes, Dennis Lane, sophomore, number 14. Turned out to be a really, really good player. Byron Dean blocking on the outside for his brother Russell.
Somehow Dean slips out of makes a positive play, but a penalty will go against
him. Again, another situation where we stopped ourselves. I think we would have moved it in that time for a touchdown, but we had a clip in a block in the back, which stopped our drive.
Third and 11.
Man, a reverse play to Byron Dean. They played well. Delay of game. Offensive coordinator couldn't get the play in time.
So fourth down and 20.
That was me. Again, base option. Just didn't really want to do anything out of the ordinary here. It's hard to pick up 20 yards on an option play, but we knew we had them backed up. We had a 14-point lead, so we played pretty conservative.
We can see the speed of Coleman, the quarterback for Satsuma.
You can keep them going lateral. They're going to come to the sideline sooner than later.
Tipped away by Farish.
Really good play by Mark Farish. Coach Vincent was a secondary coach. Did an outstanding job for us that year. I think they just completed maybe one or two passes. I have one pass for 8 yards, I think, and that might have been the only completion.
Another three and out by the line defense. And a short punt. Farish calls the fair catch. First down and 10. Kennedy on another keeper.
Again, a counterplay, one of the base plays in the option to, at that time, Dennis Lane.
Third and 7 complete to Larndine.
I think we call that 44 pass, 3, fake to the fullback. And a little slant by Pat Larndine. There he takes the ball, good protection. Nice throw and catch. Again, as you can see, Satsuma was really tough on defense. They were all the years that Coach Coleman, 11 years he coached them, they were always very sound and very fundamental defensively. They knew how to tackle.
Another third down and 7 to play. Kennedy around the left side.
Really nice gain, 6 yards, kept the drive going.
Looking for Doring in the left corner of the end zone. Just over
a little, I had a little fade route to Paul Doring and just missed the mark.
So 14-0 as we reach the end of the third quarter, Foley leading it over Satsuma. We'll come back for the final quarter right after this. Welcome back to Foley Football Classics. Foley hosting Satsuma, 1977. We go to the fourth quarter with the Lions leading the Gators 14-0, 3rd and 2 deep in Satsuma territory. Russell Dean takes the pitch left side. Sets up a 4th and 1. Kennedy keeps it. The Gators hold.
I think that's the only time they actually held us, other than the times where we either fumbled or we had a penalty in the drive. And Kim Hamrick and probably Steve Allen.
Backside pursuit.
Coleman, as I understand it, Coach Paget had the speed to go the distance if you let him get free.
Yeah, he was a very good player. Punt return by Clovis. Excellent job on the run, blocking in the back.
Following the penalty, Foley with a 1st and 10. And there's Byron Dean on the pitch. Again, Eric Kennedy does a masterful job.
Their base option, Ian took the quarterback. Great job on the outside on the block. I don't know if that was Russell Dean.
Eric Kennedy was the quintessential field leader.
Yeah, Dennis Lane's the right half back. Yeah, Eric was outstanding, very smart. He could check off at the line of scrimmage, really knew what was going on, knew when to pitch it, when to keep it.
3rd and 1, fakes it to Parker. Kennedy keeps it, gets the first down.
Great job with Greg Parker on blocking the defensive end, the one who took the dive earlier that time.
And again, another keeper by Kennedy, taking the advantage of what little the Gators are giving up there.
Nice cutback by Greg Parker. Offensive line, you can see they're really coming off the ball well.
Oh, man. Yeah.
Ball gets away from us, but I believe this one's going to come back. And it does.
Good.
Mark Ferris in coverage. He was our outside linebacker, what we call the weak side linebacker or the wheel linebacker.
Is that Bobby again? Bobby Ray.
Bobby Ray. Really good open field tackle. We get one stand out and good block Anthony Johns.
Bobby Ray with the knack for being at the right place at the right time. All the time, it seemed.
Bobby was a great middle linebacker. Great, great job there initially. I think it was Kim Henry. Number 62.
Gator receiver juggling the ball. Moved incomplete, fourth and two. Gators like to go for it. There's Cameron.
Big play, Kim Henry. About a 12, 13 yard loss.
Nice job by Hammer.
Big, big play.
Setson, my coach, said later on, I know we had a lot of good players, but he said after scouting us, he said, if I could pick one player off y'all's team, I'd pick your center. So that's a big compliment for Tom Burns.
Tom Burns, number 54.
Tom was one of the best. He can come off the football and get a standing blocker and a great leader.
Foley Football Hall of Famer. There's a pitch to Dennis Lane, left side, and Lane will scamper in for the touchdown.
Dennis was just a sophomore and had two great years as a junior and senior, number 14, right halfback. Good fake to Greg Parker. The end slow played it. Eric did just the right thing. He tried to force and freeze him, make him take him and pitch the ball by our Dean, block it on the outside, offensive line. Did a great job.
Well, a lot of unselfishness in that backfield too, Coach.
It really was. In our offense, the backs had to be as much blockers, really more so than runners. And they had to be very, very unselfish to block for each other. And they certainly did, along with the fullback. The fullback didn't care all that much. He was set up as a blocker or faked the ball to him. But Greg and Robert Cantrell did a great job.
Greg Parker's extra point attempt was good. Foley takes a 21-0 lead with 2:52 remaining in the football game.
And the same thing's about being unselfish with the receivers. Pat Lardine and Clovis Snow and Paul Doran, we didn't throw the ball all that much in those days, but they were great blockers. They had to block on the outside, and they certainly did.
So Foley with a commanding 21-0 lead late in the game. Things are looking good for the Lions in this critical Region 2 matchup.
Great job, Bobby Ray. I think Bobby might have tipped it. This was the third. They got a first down on a penalty. I think that was the third one and two of them on penalties by us. They didn't earn the one first down in the game. So, fantastic job by the defense. I guess that was the third one right there.
First and 10, the Gators in an obvious passing situation here.
Stay on your feet, all right.
Anthony Yachts.
All right, had a chance for glory there.
Colby Snowden, Mark Parrish. had several guys on pass defense.
Fourth and 10. Coleman can't find anybody open.
Anthony Yance flagged him down. Spying him out. He's playing a little soft, like I was talking about, containing.
Yeah, these guys wanted to shut out really, really bad.
He's wanting to get another interception, I think.
And actually, we talked about having five shutouts. They really had six shutouts because we gave Fairhope 2 points at the end of the season. The last game of the season, we beat them 7-2. So the defense really had a shutout in that game.
Benton comes in at quarterback. And that'll do it. Final score, Foley beats Satsuma 21-0 to take full command of the Region 2 race, 1977. And we'll come back with more this edition of Foley Football Classics right after this. Welcome back to this edition of Foley Football Classics, 1977. Foley takes a 21-0 victory over Region 2 rival Satsuma to take full command of the Region 2 race. Would go on to finish the season with victories over the Baldwin County High School Tigers of Bay Minette and the Fairhope Pirates, thus making them the fourth team in Foley history to go undefeated in the regular season. They would then host the Sydney Lanierers, the first round of the playoffs, and a classic slugfest coming up just short of that game by a final score of 22-15. Coach Lester Smith, head coach of the Foley Lions, final thoughts on that classic matchup and that big victory over Satsuma in 1977?
Well, it was a huge win for us, and for me personally, it was almost a relief because Coach Coleman had beat us 2 years in a row in 75 and 76, and you were beginning to wonder, you know, whether you were out-coached or not, but our players played so hard and so well in that game and really wanted the game. And it was such a huge game from the standpoint of being a region game. Satsuma was really good in those days. And we knew that we had two more tough games to go against Bay Minette and Fairhope, which turned out to be tough games as well. But to gain over 300 yards against Satsuma, a team that always played really good defense and always played us tough, and to hold them to 56 yards, I think it was, in the game was really huge. And to hold them to one first down was really remarkable when you get to thinking about it. They earned one first down, and we gave them two on penalties. And as a coach, you always look for things that you can improve on. And, of course, we had one turnover in the game, I believe it was, and two drives that were stopped by penalties. But other than that, it was really hard to find fault with anything that the players did. They were ready to play, and they proved it in that game.
Coach Bud Pigott, defensive coordinator for the Foley Lions. Again, Coach Pigott, the Satsuma comes into this game, the seventh game of the season, with a lot of momentum, undefeated just like we were. You knew that you had to contain their quarterback. Coleman did a great job, did the Lions defense in keeping them contained all game long. Satsuma, this was a very, very good Satsuma team with only one loss, I guess it was, against the Viger Wolves coming into that week seven matchup, and would go on with only two losses that year set to the Viger Wolves and to the Foley Lions. We would record their only shutout of the season. But talk about your thoughts as you look back on that game and the defensive performance.
Well, I was pleased with our effort. I thought I can't ever remember looking back where we didn't have great effort. It always tickles you when you got great effort and you get people in the right position so they can contribute to most of the team. And another thing that made it a little sweet was I can't remember where I heard him say it, or Coach Coleman had told somebody prior to this that Foley's only lost five games in the last however many years, and two of them were to Satsuma. It was just like a feather in his hat to have beaten us twice. So that just added to the incentive. I think they even got to be almost like a county. Our players looked on them almost like a county rivalry, even though they, you know, you can't hardly get any stronger than the rivalry within the county, but it got to be that way.
Yeah, it was a rivalry, I think, that spread even into baseball, as I remember, between Foley and Satsuma. But it was a rivalry, as you said, they were almost an extended Baldwin County school in a lot of ways.
And it kind of extends your reputation even more. I mean, we were sitting in Ladd Stadium scouting. I've forgotten who we were scouting. But we wasn't in the press box. We was down, and we heard one guy ask another one over here. He said, "Hey, who y'all playing next week?" Maybe this was a Saturday night or something. He said, "We got Foley." And another guy says, "Man, when you cross that water, you got to play."
Well, it was such a big win because in 75, 76, and 77, the years that these seniors played, we lost four games in those 3 years, and two of them were Satsuma. So it was a really huge win for us to win that game and be 8-0 and have a chance to be one of the few teams, the third team at that point in time, to be 10-0. And so it was really huge for us.
Did you feel like that really set you up in a good position for the remaining games left on the schedule?
We really did. We knew that Baymanette was going to be good, and they were in those days too. I mean, in the 60s, 70s, Baymanette was really, really tough, and so was Fairhope in a lot of those years. But we knew we had a really good team, and that our kids were going to give great effort. And as it turned out, the last two games were pretty close games. We beat Baymanette, I think it was 12-0, and beat Fairhope 7-2. So they were hard ball games and really tough wins, but we knew we had a really good chance to finish undefeated.
We knew that this game too was going to, the winner of this game would be in the driver's seat for the region championship, and it turned out to be the case. Foley
Absolutely.
Finished as region champions that year following the finishing out undefeated, and Satsuma finished up, I think, as the region runner-up.
I believe that's right.
Hugely successful season for the Foley Lions, just our fourth in team history. At that point, to go undefeated, 10-0, and to make it to the playoffs, Coach Smith, back in that era, which was, I think this was the 12th year, I believe, of the playoff era, which began in 1966. This was our first year to enter the state playoffs. It was extremely difficult back in those days to reach the playoffs. You had to be a region champion. I think there was a scenario that it included just a handful of wild card teams, and I'm not sure even when that came into play, if that was in place in 1977 or not, but you had to pretty much win the region to make it to the playoffs. So it was a much different format than it is now. If you look at that scenario now, both Foley and Satsuma would have been a host team in the first round under the present playoff system. We would have gone just about every year during those days to the state playoffs under the current format. But as you look back on the season overall, and I look at it coming off of 1976, the year before, you come into 77 with a completely different offensive backfield, with eventually Eric Kennedy emerging as the starter at quarterback, and then of course the entire backfield was a new bunch, having replaced a very talented group the year before in Flowers, Steve Flowers at quarterback, and Chisholm Hall and Fortune and Robert Peterson. So you had a whole new group in the backfield, and of course all across the team on the offensive line. I think you knew pretty well that your defense had a good nucleus coming back on that side.
Yes, we had a really good defensive team coming back, and we knew that. We had several that had played a lot in 76, but not that much on offense. I think Tom Byrne and Kenny Neal were starters pretty much in 76, and Byron Dean and Russell played quite a bit, but pretty much the offense was new. Most of the offensive linemen were new. Our receivers were pretty much new. But the defense was really solid. We knew the defense pretty much had to carry us in the game. Saying this about how hard it was to get in the playoffs, just to show you, in 71, we were 7-2-1, didn't get in the playoffs. 72, we were 7-2-1, didn't get in the playoffs. 74, we were 7-3 and didn't get in the playoffs. 75, we were 8-2 and didn't get in the playoffs. 76, we were 8-2 and didn't get in the playoffs. And then even after that, the next year in 78, we were 8-2 and didn't get in the playoffs. In 79, we were 9-1 and didn't get in the playoffs.
And that was the year of the hurricane, where there was some technicality.
That's right.
That if a game had been played, just if it had been played, we would have gotten in the playoffs.
Exactly right. Very tough thing in 79 after these seniors had left, but we were 9-1. lost a 10-7 game to Bank Manette. We scored 292 points, gave up 31, had six shutouts, and did get in the playoffs. So go figure.
Yeah.
So I just showed you in the 70s how hard it was to get in the playoffs. And 1980, we were 7-3 and didn't get in the playoffs, for example. 1982, we were 8-2 and didn't get in the playoffs. So the 77 team, we pretty much either had to win them all or at least win the region championship because, as you said, in those days, the way the system worked, if I recall, there were 12 A-team regions in each class, and we were 4A, which was the top class in Alabama at the time, which meant there were 96 teams in 4A football. So you had the 12 region champions, and then they picked four wild card teams, and they picked one wild card out of every three regions. Out of region 1, 2, and 3, there was one wild card. Out of 4, 5, and 6, there was one, and so forth through the various regions, the 12 regions. So to get in, that's the way it was in 79. We had another great team that, as I mentioned, that were 9-1, lost a three-point game to Bank Manette, and didn't get in the playoffs. So it was a remarkable performance by this 7-7 team to win the region. We had a couple of really close games, 7-6 to Robertsdale in the first game of the season, as you mentioned, 7-2 to Fairhope to end the season. But the eight games in between, we really played good football, really tough football. Wanted to say, too, just a word about just by going undefeated itself. We've had six undefeated teams in the history of Foley football. The first was 1930, 8-0-1, a team that was really good under Coach Adams. Coach Jones had two undefeated teams in 61 and 62, the 7-7 team that went undefeated. Then there were two others. Jimmy Nasser had an undefeated team in 1995, and Todd Watson had one in 2007. So in the 95-year history of Foley football, there have been six undefeated teams, five that actually went 10-0. So it's an extremely difficult thing to go undefeated. So it's a remarkable achievement in a lot of ways. So you one time out of every 19 years or whatever to have a 10-0 season on an average. So it's quite a record. I want to say just a word or two also about the defense. We said a lot of things about the defense in this particular game, but I want to say something about Coach Paget, about the defenses that he ran for all those years. He was defense coordinator for 17 years at Foley, from 1969 through 1985. And during that period of time, I was looking back through some of the statistics. We had 10 seasons in which we gave up 9 points or less per game. We had 10 seasons in which we had, we had 7 seasons in which we had 7 games that we gave up less than 10 points in. We had 43 shutouts in those 17 years that he was defensive coordinator. We had 99 games in which we gave up 9 points or less in those games. In those, he coached 174 games. And I figured it up. We had, I believe it was 136 games that I recall in which we gave up 2 or less touchdowns in a game. And you just think about that. 136 games out of 174 that we gave up either 2 touchdowns or less than 2 touchdowns in. The 79 team and 81 team had only one game in which they gave up 10 or more points in. So 9 games, we gave up less than 9 points or less in that game. He's a Hall of Fame coach in Baldwin County, a Hall of Fame coach at Foley High School. Just a remarkable coach. Coach Vincent did a great job helping him with the secondary during those years. I also want to compliment a couple other coaches. Coach Barry Pennington, who is also a Hall of Fame coach in Baldwin County and at Foley High School. Coach Pennington coached our offensive line for the 4 of those years in 74, 75, 76, and 77. He went on to win the state championship at Jackson High School. Came back to coach at Foley for 2 years, went 16-4 in regular season in those 2 years. Great offensive line coach, great coach, period, great head coach. And also, Jim Nasry, who coached with us as well. Coach Nasry was our junior high coach and also the assistant football coach on the varsity level for a total of 15 years. He also stayed and became head coach at Foley for 7 years. During that time, they were undefeated in 1995, as I mentioned. And he's in the Hall of Fame, in Baldwin County Hall of Fame at Foley High School. And actually, his team in 1995 was the first one to actually win 11 games. They won their first playoff game that year, had a 10-0 season, and won the first playoff game. Then Coach Watson, a number of years later, in 2007, went undefeated, 10-0, and actually won the first two playoff games, and only team, I believe, still in Foley's history to win 12 games in the season. So we had some great coaches. I was very fortunate to have those guys coach with me for a number of years. They stayed with us all those 17 years. And I mentioned that there were 99 games in which we had less than 10 points in. But, Coach, I was trying to find that 100th game, and I couldn't find it. But we had five games in 1968 when you were coaching defense. So counting that, I wasn't a head coach. Coach Jones was the head coach that year, of course, his last year as head coach. So that's 104 games that Coach Paget coached defense in where we gave up nine or fewer points. That is an unbelievable record. And so you can see the coaches we had. But I want to just say this. The players actually make it happen, and the work that they put into it, the effort that they gave. Coach Paget mentioned a while ago about effort. We never had to worry about effort with our teams. They gave great effort. They practiced hard. They worked hard during the summer, during the off season, during spring training. The whole season, they got after it. And you never had to worry about whether they're going to give 100% or not. You just watch the defense swarm the ball. And whether it's 1977, 79, 72, it didn't matter. You just look at those old films, and they got after it. And so it's a credit to them. I was proud to coach with the guys that I mentioned, but the players win games, and it's a real credit to them. And they taught us a lot. I hope we taught them a little bit ourselves, but they're the ones that make it happen. And my credit goes to them, along with the coaches like Coach Paget and Coach Pennington and Coach Benson and Coach Nasry.
Coach Paget, that defense labeled tougher than jerky and meaner than junkyard dogs. I think that was spot on. These guys, they just love to hit. They love to get after people. We saw it in the video of that 1977 game against Satsuma.
We did have some hitters now. And a lot of just open field single tackles were boom. Our punt return licks on punt return. That's like you say, particularly this group enjoyed the punt returns. And if I was old Clovis, I'd be glad to have that group in front of me, because if I can ever get to the alley, I don't know how many ran back, but we always had pretty good yardage, seemed like, on those. Some of them got a little more anxious and clipped every once in a while. But personnel, when you start deciding on personnel for the next year, you're getting ready for the next year and the next year, and you're trying to see where they'll fit in best into your scheme. And then, as it was, me and Coach Smith would want the same person, which means we wasn't going platoon. They just got to go both ways. And that's the reason for all them grass drills and stuff, because even if you were a scout team guy, you still had to do everything that those people that's going to play it on the line for every play of the game or until the game's out of reach. So I'm proud of them guys that just get after it and just work and work and work and work and work.
Well, I think the same is said about this coaching staff. I know that in my role and having the privilege of sitting down with Coach Smith on Fridays to record our weekly radio show, Coach Smith would tell me about Coach Paget's defense. He would say, Coach Paget knows what the other team is going to do before the other team knows what they're going to do. That was always the case, and that's putting those teams, studying the opponent, every way that you can study and knowing what their tendencies are. And you look at the game the way it is now and the way that teams with all the advancements of, high-tech film review and being able to to chart plays the way that you can. Back then it was done probably a little bit more laboriously, but y'all studied film a lot, I know, and knew the opponents well before you ever got on the field.
We did. We had those 16mm, but we'd work on Saturday for several hours. We'd work on Sunday afternoon, and a lot of times we'd come back up after church on Sunday night even and work, particularly if it was a really big game. So we put a lot into it, even in off season. You know, we'd watch films and study our opponents and so forth. And so it was a team effort. Everybody really pitched in and did a great job. Let me just say one other thing about the players and their record. The senior group, the 77 senior group, they were 26-4 in regular season their 3 years. The junior group was 26-4 their 3 years. The sophomore group was 27-3 their 3 years. And if you look at it from 1975 to 1979, the 5 years that those three groups played, we were 43-7, which was the second best 5 year period in Foley's history. The best was 60-64, where we went 47-3, and I was privileged to play in two of those 5 years. So I was a part of both of those, but. Coach Jones went 47-3 in those 5 years, 60-64, but we were 43-7. So these guys, and we came within an eyelash of winning three or four of those that we actually lost. But it was a real credit to the players and Coach Packett and Coach Pennington and Coach Nazar and Coach Benson.
Let me tell you about Coach Smith, just about film preparation, and he was a he'd watch the film, he'd watch it on Saturday, watch it on Sunday afternoons, watch it every day after kids was gone, watch it again, and then he'd take the projector home with him. And we was getting ready to play Viger. And he said, I think we can run a boot, and they had some grown men on their team back in those days. I mean, it was the University of Viger, is what colleges called them, the University of Viger, anyway. So he said, I think I can run a bootleg on that end. And he had probably seventh grade, he had a full beard. He was something. So anyway, so he run the power play to the opposite side, and sure enough, that rascal came across, all the way across, and made the tackle about 2 yards deep. The next play, I think Lewis Wilson was the quarterback.
Yeah.
Fakes that same play. Here comes that old end. He's cutting right off the tackle's tail. Here he's coming. And he's sticking the only he doesn't have the ball. And look, on the film, I remember watching it from our sideline on the film, and you see their coaches on their sideline, and you see him fake that ball real good and hanging on his hip, and turn, and there's nobody left. I think he went about 65 or 70 yards for a touchdown. Remember that one? But I remember him saying that like on Monday. I think we run a bootleg on that end. And that took all the starch out of it. And their coaches were all jumping, reverse, reverse, bootleg.
Yeah, we watched a lot of films in those days. And the players watched a lot of films. They'd come up on Saturday and watch the films with us. And
fight over them assists. Fight over who made the assist.
Exactly.
1977, once again, a special season, 10-0 in the regular season, and Foley's first appearance in the AHSAA state playoffs. We're going to come back and visit with some of the players from that 1977 team right after this.
The day before the game, I was heartbroken when I found out I had strep throat. I had a throat, 104-degree fever, and Dr. Taylor said I couldn't play. And I wanted to play very bad, so I wasn't even going to tell my mother what he said, but he called her and told her not to let me play in the game, and I begged her to let me play. And she said, well, go ask the coach. I was out of school that day before the game, so I didn't go to practice, but I went up there with my mother to practice, and I asked Coach Smith if I could play, and he said, well, if you feel like it. And I said, okay. So anyway, I played the game, but luckily I made it through it. I think it was my worst game of the whole season. Well, I was just glad that we won. It was a tough game for me, and I was just glad to be part of it. I mean, and we had a really good group of coaches that inspired us to play, and I was highly motivated to do my best. and I didn't want to let anybody down. That's just the way it was.
In this game, leading up to this game, Coach Pigott, he kept telling Robert and myself, whatever you do, don't let the quarterback get outside of you. If you let him get outside of you, it's over. And so myself, that's the first thing I was doing, was trying to run as fast as I could to the sideline to keep him inside. But it was a very good game. We had we were clicking on all eight. We were really doing really well. But after the game, it was a relief because it was probably the biggest game we played all year long as far as having to win. We were winning every week. We were winning and getting better and better and better. But the team that we were up against had our number the previous years. They knew what to do to beat us, and we weren't going to let that happen. So through team effort, both offense and defense, we all did our jobs and thought we did it well. So it was good.
Like I said, that I kind of remember the same thing. Coach tells us, whatever you do, don't let him get outside. So if you watch the game, you've seen we spent more time running down sideline, down the the line there, keeping him in than anything. But it was a tough game, and there was a lot of good players behind me. All I had to do was slow them down. That was my goal.
The games were always something that we geared up for. Competition was something that we, I think, thrived on. We had some excellent coaches. Preparing for that game was not anything different than before. One of the biggest things I remember was listening to George S. Patton's speech, Coach. Once you listen to that speech, there's not a lot left to be said as far as being ready to go out and basically annihilate whoever's in front of you. And that was one of the, I think, greatest things I remember about preparing for the game, is going through that message and basically just using that as a preparation for battle. And when we went out on the field as a team and a unit, you know, that's what we did. We went out prepared for that battle, and we each of us had a job to do. And as a unit, I think we pulled together and we did a great job and enjoyed playing with those guys. And that game was a tremendous game. And after the game, we were absolutely ecstatic that we were able to end that two-game losing streak to Satsuma. So,
being the smallest guy on the line is a lot. I was pretty beat up during that game. Felt pretty bad after the game. One of the main things I remember in preparatory for the game, the week of practice before the game, is the coaching staff preaching to us, practice doesn't make perfect. Perfect practice makes perfect. And after that game, it showed.
The Satsuma game, the year before, I don't know if a lot of y'all remember, but on the school bus, we got beat by Satsuma in Satsuma. We had some seniors, I know you know one of them, Mike Jones, and Joe Benton. And it was a bad game. I mean, it was a dog fight with them. We come out on the short end of the stick. And they come on the bus after we coming home, and there were some things said I can't repeat, but they made us take a vow that we was going to get them back that game, this game, our senior year. And I took a lot of that and played in that game. And I think a lot of us did. And you saw what the end result, how it turned out.
And I remember coming into the game, the coaches were preparing us for the game because they just barely beat us the first couple of years, and it's kind of like Doug was saying earlier, we had a little revenge factor there, so I remember being prepared for that. Then kind of after the game, I think it really set our identity for us as a team because we were kind of like a family, and all the coaches, like, you know, were behind us and everything they tried to do, have us prepared, have us ready for the game. And I think, like coaches were saying earlier, about 100%, we gave 110% every game. And we established identity. After we established our identity, we felt like we could go to the next level. We had just passed that hurdle, so we were ready for the county games that were coming, Fairhope and Baymanette. And, you know, it really meant a lot, too. I know it meant a lot to me personally is going 10-0 because we were kind of setting the pace for the earlier teams when Coach Smith played on back in the 60s because they were the legends. And we kind of want to be, you know, remembered as they were, you know, a really good team. So I think we established our identity, then we, you know, and as of today, we still have an identity. It's been a hard record to beat. Some of the statistics that Coach read. So we really did a good job, I thought. Thank you.
The big thing I remember about the Satsuma Region Championship game was the practice the week before was extremely tough. A lot of grass drills and a lot of hard work. And it was a lot of hype about the game, and I was kind of different in a way. I took some tape and put on my helmet, and I wrote on there Gator Wrestler on the helmet, and it's in the scrapbook over there. But I wore it the whole game on my helmet, and it was kind of fired me up, and maybe the defensive guys a little more than I wanted to, but it was a huge game, region championship game, and like Pat said and some others, I mean, we really gelled with that and came together as a family and a team. Like my daddy used to say, you know, we never really had one real superstar on the team. We just had a bunch of good guys that loved to play ball and that kind of thing. One other thing I'd like to say is you may have noticed in the film, sometimes Eric Kennedy, our quarterback, and he and I grew up playing backyard ball, as a lot of us played ball together in little leagues and so forth. But we had a thing when we got up to the line, and if he saw there was a gap and we had a short distance to go or to the goal line, he would just – I was center and he was quarterback, and he'd tap me on the side of my tail there, and that meant we were going to go real close next to me, so I knew which way to block, you know. But we did that several times, and I noticed that in the film, which was pretty neat. But it was a great game. Proud to be here.
You know, as I think back about it, where it was in the season, we were well into the season. We had had a tremendous amount of momentum. And going into that game, all I remember was we were just a bunch of winners, and we didn't know how to lose. In fact, we didn't know how to lose throughout even those that were ahead of us in years ahead. So we went out with a lot of confidence because we were well prepared and we were well coached, and we knew our coaches had the winning combination in the way of plays and how to call the game and everything. So what I remember too was noted about that particular game was Coach Coleman had his son was quarterback. And he was a star quarterback in the entire region. And one of the things that was really memorable to me in that particular game is that we had to stop him. And our defense did an amazing job of getting that done that night. And our coaches did a great job of preparing us for him. Anytime that a team had a one-player almost type team, a star, Coach Pigott had a way of dealing with that with our defense. That you couldn't beat us with a one superstar player team. So as I went into it, we were prepared, confident. Coach Pennington had the offensive line ready, fired up before the game, and there were just one thing I thought in mind. We're gonna win this thing, and we went away with a 21-0 victory. And I'm just thankful to be a part of a winning group like this, a bunch of winning men.
What I remember about that game first is the year before we did get beat 10-7. I remember that was a hard-fought game over at Satsuma. Seemed like there was even some scuffling going on the sidelines after tackles and that sort of thing. So it did become a rivalry, almost like a county rivalry, like's been talked about earlier today. And so we were all fired up to practice that week and ready for the game. And that's probably the most memorable game of that year that I can remember the score. I remembered apparently correctly that we had about 300 yards rushing. I didn't remember any passing yards or any passes at all, but apparently we did have two or three that Pat caught. And I'll always remember that. I mean, we were ready to go. We were going to beat them. And we pounded them on the ground, and the defense stopped them cold and took care of things.
Looking back on different games and people that we used to play, I look at somebody like Satsuma as somebody you're supposed to beat every year. But they happened to get a coach over there who recruited people just like himself, and they were almost obsessed with Foley. They would break down, y'all don't know this, but Howard Busby told me, he said, I've broken down every film we've ever had on y'all every year. I put them all together from the year before, the year before, the year before, and we're going to know what you're going to do, because he was a defensive coordinator. He said, we're going to know what you're going to do, you know, and that's the end of it. And I told Coach about that, what he had told me, and you know, it didn't really bother Lester or anything, mere fact that we're going to do what we're going to do. In those years, we were going to do what we were going to do offensively, regardless of what you did. And we had so many things we could do that if you were stopping something, if you watched the film, you noticed in the first half we ran the option, but it was a different kind of option, and we didn't pitch the ball much. But in the second half, we came back and started riding that thing and pulling it out, stepping down, reading it, and pitching it, or having a base pitch, which created a situation where, hey, they wouldn't stopping it. We got a lot of yards on the option. It's like Lester told me one time. I said, what's the one thing that just kind of bothers you about people? He said, why do y'all keep pitching that ball? And he turned to me and said, because we get 6.8 yards average a pitch. And to me, that's a seller. For me as a coach, that's all I had to hear. So that's what I did the rest of my coaching career. You have to change, but you hang with the things that you do well. And that's what you did here. Foley had a great program. When I came down here, I came from somewhere else. And all I could see was all these little old pee-hunkers running around. I'm going, wow, how are we going to beat anybody? And how'd they beat us at Fairup all those years? You know, they had all these little bitty old guys. But I tell you what, when I came down here, I found out why they stayed little, didn't I, Anthony? Because he'd take you and put you to the limit all year long. And this is before other schools were doing this. Something you got to understand. We were doing stuff that other schools weren't doing. And we were going to get, he got the most out of his people. And so I know when I left, that's what I did. I did the same kind of stuff when I went to Jackson. They ran the same defense as Bud Pickett. They ran the same offense, same terminology. Everything was the same. Because here it was proven to me that it was a winning way. I coached a long time, ran a lot of good athletes. Down here, we didn't have all those kind of good athletes. We had some good ones, don't get me wrong now, but we didn't have any of them. It was more hard-nosed. And when I came back down here after being at Fairhope and was the head coach down here, I come back down and had to go through that same realization again. These daggum small pee-hunkers down here. And I've got to live Fairhope with all those giants come down here, you know, and that's what it amounts to. You know, you gotta realize that y'all really did way more than a lot of other places did with what they had. Y'all really reached your potential to go 10-0.
About the Satsuma game, the thing that's most important to me is that it probably, I think, if I'm not mistaken, was the first game that I ever lost as coaching as a Foley coach. And it gave me just a little bit more zeal to try to win the next time we played them. We played them again in 76 and lost to them again on a very close game and some very questionable calls by the referees.
No calls.
So we really came out trying to win this game, and that game we won. And one of those Satsuma games, I was given the game ball. I don't know whether it was this game or not.
I remember in the senior square that day of the Satsuma game, he came dressed as Billy Coleman, the coach. And anyway, Big Chew, and he was going and had everybody fired up. Remember that?
Yeah. That was something that I really enjoyed with the students, that the cheerleaders would come to me and see if we put the skit together during break time. And I'd get up on the wall and kind of do some things to try to rouse up the guys and get them fired up. And that day especially, I dressed up as Billy Coleman and had a Satsuma hat on. I don't know where I got it, but I got one. And got me a big chaw, which I played a lot of softball, Pat Laurendine. And I chewed some anyway, so I put a big chaw in there and just spitting on everybody and getting them fired up and telling them about last year's game and how we had lost a close one and that this one was important to us. But I'll end by saying I'm a blessed man because I got to coach as Foley with these guys.
I know we were just a group of average people. There weren't any superstars on our team, but the difference was the coaches. They instilled a winning attitude and a work ethic in us in a way that it stuck, and it affected our lives, you know, from while we were playing, plus all the way through to the day. And I can't thank y'all enough. I mean, y'all were very inspirational to us as we were, you know, coming up, and we couldn't have done it without y'all. There's no way. We owe our winning season to y'all, our values, our work ethic, and our heart. Every day, y'all had an inspirational message for us. And at the time, when you're a teenager, the stuff really, you know, it kind of goes over your head. But thinking back on it, that was the difference for us, is y'all. Y'all did it for us. Just inspired us to not accept defeat. And I thank y'all very much, and all the rest of the team. I had a great time. I love playing football. I was sorry when it was over. Just thanks to all of y'all.
Well, I'm going to have to say that academics wasn't my strongest point in high school, but I did what I had to come out here to play for these coaches, and there was a tremendous impact on my life. After I got out of high school, I went in the Air Force, and let me tell you, boot camp was a breeze. I said, this is all y'all got? So, I mean, the work ethics they taught us was tremendous and carried you through life. Like I say, and I appreciate them.
I'd say just learned a lot of life lessons from the coaches here. They were our role models, and I think it's come from that. A lot of these guys, some of these guys I hadn't seen in years, but I think we're just a family relationship. Some of these guys, like I was saying, I hadn't seen them in years, but it just like those yesterday. We got to talking about things, you know, it's just in a relationship that we built with these people from all different backgrounds, a lot of Foley people, a lot of Alberta people, but we had just all come together at one during this time in 77, and we left a legend here for everybody. You know, everybody worked hard on the field and the effort that we gave, so I'm just proud to be part of this as well, and like Coach was saying, once a line, always a Foley line.
Just wanted to say, Coach, thank you, all of you, for your Christian attitude and your example that you set. I didn't meet the Lord till I was 24, and I had several coaches after you, Coach Pikett, and believe me, none of them could hold a candle to your ethics and your integrity like you guys showed us. Our senior year was a blast. It was fun. We had a great time, mainly because you guys led us and taught us how to win a game. And after I met the Lord, the example that y'all set really really touched home and has meant a lot to me ever since then. So I do appreciate that, and thank you for it.
Well, 40 years later, here we are again. You know, guys, we're all still winners. We were the best. That's it. First off, I'd like to say thanks to all the coaches for teaching us and instilling us values to make us better men in life. And then I would like to thank all these players that I played with for all the times that we had together growing up, from the time we were small till the time we were grown. I've enjoyed these times immensely, and if it wasn't for people like our coaches teaching us the way we should do things in life, and it's a pleasure. It was a pleasure playing for them, and it was a pleasure playing with all of y'all.
As I've always said, you taught us so much more than X's and O's. The game of life, you know, and then the secret of the slight edge, which Coach used to pass around. I still have copies of those. And I've used them all throughout my life. But just so much more than X's and O's. And like Lester said, talking about making us become men and that kind of thing, and have qualities and practice things throughout our life, you know. So it's much appreciated. As well as this event. I'm speaking also on behalf of Eric Kennedy, who is not here today, our quarterback. He sent me some things, emailed me yesterday that he'd like to say, and I'll just sum it up in this one thing. He was most appreciative. Eric and I were really close growing up. We grew up a block from each other, two blocks, but his father died when he was 12, and y'all may remember that. But y'all were his father figures, and that's what he sent me yesterday in the email, was how y'all helped him develop as a man. And I thought that was really good, you know, and I think we all can probably relate to some of that, because we learn so much more than X's and O's, and I'm just proud to be a part of this team. So,
but Coach Smith, he was talking about earlier about how we worked hard in the off season. You know, we didn't get to go to study hall or PE. We come over to Coach Smith and Coach Pike's study hall PE class. And I think, we didn't like it at the time, but, you know, I think it helped us a lot. Then we got to go play baseball, some of us, and Coach Vincent gets us, you know. And if you take Central Nell's game pants up there in Old Bow, he can put an extra 500 stadiums on you, too. Well, if you remember that or not. But he taught us some lessons, and we appreciate it because it's carried with us through our lives as adults. And we worked hard growing up. We played a little league together, baseball, football. And with the Central Near game, I remember the last play of the quarter. I mean, that was it, you know. But it really wasn't it. I mean, we had to keep going through life, and what y'all taught us, and playing together with these winners here. Me personally, I've carried it through life. Appreciate it.
I think one thing I've always thought about, and it goes back to, we didn't like to lose as a team. We were not going to lose. We never even thought about losing. Coach Smith every week would give us a scouting report, and it didn't matter who we were playing. They could have been 1-9, and we thought they were really good and could definitely beat us, so we knew we had to work hard that week. Preparing for whoever we played.
Every game was an important game, and to win is win both on the football field and in life. It's a series of preparation for the next adventure you're going to take. And as I think back about some of the things that I learned on a core level here, growing up on a farm and having to work on the farm, and sometimes even having to, without choice, miss practices occasionally, our coaches held us to a standard that all players would be treated the same, no matter whether we worked at home or whether we were working here on the field and was here at every practice. I've got some scars on my knee shins here, some chunks out of the front of it, and I think they're on that stadium on the north side over here that got left from doing makeup practice stadiums. While at the same time, when I wasn't able to be here, I was having to work. But I think that I want to thank you guys for making me do that work. I really needed that to prepare me for what God would have for me in my future and career. And as I look back now, over owning and operating a $200 million a year company with hundreds of employees around the United States, a lot of core principles were taught to me here. I was taught to be a man. I learned how to be a man. And I learned how to win. And I learned how to be around a bunch of winners. And I don't see it any other way. In fact, in my brain today at 58 years old, we beat Siddle in the air. That'll never change. Because on the field, as I think about that game for me, that great playoff game here, it was the easiest team we played. It was the softest team we played. And we really could do anything we wanted to do on offense. We were prepared for the game, and on the field, we won that game. And that's the way it'll go down in my record. And I do believe and I'm convinced that we would have been the state championship team that year, even with the playoff system and everything as it is, as it was during our time. But I couldn't be more proud of the coaches, Coach Smith and Coach Pigott, Coach Pennington, Coach Vinson. Coach Pennington made us work like it was on the offensive line, like we worked on the farm. And there wasn't any, there was no slacking. And that's helped me, again, in life, that I don't allow any slacking in my life right now. And nor do I allow it around me. And so it's helped me. Football here at Foley High School dramatically helped me build the career and life and business and organization that I now lead today. And I want to thank the coaches for the investment that you guys made in our lives, your godliness, your leadership, and toughness, and taught me how to be tough. And for all the players, you know, here, I couldn't be more proud of being on a team with you guys and just a bunch of winners. And I don't, you know, Coach Smith earlier mentioned the fact that we weren't a bunch of superstar athletes. But when I think about it, I think we were a bunch of superstar athletes. We just may not have had the frames and the talent that others did, but we were just absolute winners. And I find that winners come in all kinds of packages, and they may not be the strongest, tallest, biggest. They may be the little guy that just got more heart and gut that will whip you every time. And in business, I face those kind of giants as well. And it's been a great pleasure to be able to play with you guys. And for this event today, it's very meaningful to me to get to share these comments with you guys, because I know without a question I wouldn't be where I'm at today had it not been for us, this team, these coaches, and the investment that we've had in our lives. And I hope that I've brought something to bear that adds value to each one of you guys as well.
But it's a great group. They're as good a people, or better people, than they were as athletes. Y'all weren't really that talented. I hate to break the news to you, but I don't mean to burst y'all's bubble, but on the standpoint of when we looked at athletes that we played against, that's the reason it's so amazing that y'all beat them. And you beat them on heart and effort and conditioning and hard work. The unity, the oneness. Y'all believe the sky was the limit, and we can win with what we got. And if you play hard, you play together, we can beat them in the fourth quarter. We out-conditioned them. We outwork them. You bought into it, and we were able to do it. Ability that you had with the effort that you had and getting after it was remarkable. And you'll remember it forever that you were an undefeated team, only one of five 10-0 teams in the history of the school. That's pretty remarkable. And I'm proud of every one of you, proud of the way that you turned out as far as people, and that's even more important.